What I wanted to do this morning is talk a little bit about the Lord's Prayer. If you recall, today, though, in both the epistle and the gospel reading, we heard some very important things. We heard the Lord Jesus say, basically, in essence, the golden rule. Do unto others as you would have them do to you. We've talked about that many times before. We've talked about St. Paul saying in the scripture reading for today and the epistle reading that Eve read, that you, meaning you, the people here gathered, are the temple of the living God. That you yourselves are living, walking, breathing, talking temples. We've talked about that also. But I wanted to kind of return back to some very basic things. So I wanted to talk about the Lord's Prayer today. And I'll probably spill that over into next week as well. Because there's so much to talk about that I can't possibly cover everything in 15 minutes or 20 minutes or even 2 or 3 hours. We could spend days on the Lord's Prayer. I once did a Bible study here at St. Paul's for 12 consecutive weeks, 2 hours at a time, just on the Lord's Prayer. And so there's a lot to, I guess I'd say, figure out about the Lord's Prayer. So, probably as you know, today being a Sunday, I'm sure you must understand that Christians all over the world have been praying the Lord's Prayer today. Probably billions of people have prayed the Lord's Prayer today on a Sunday when we as Christians gather for worship. And that prayer has been prayed in hundreds of different languages, hundreds. And so this prayer is the prayer. I need to make that very clear. This prayer is the prayer for Christians, and not a few of the saints believe that this prayer is a summary of the entire gospel, not only teaching us how to pray and what to pray for, but also teaching us how we are to live as Christians, because our prayer and our life need to match. They have to line up with one another. Yet more often than not, to be honest, we say the prayer in Elizabethan English in a translation that is somewhat inaccurate, quite frankly, not really even paying attention to the words or what they mean. We say it most often by rote. And of course, as children, that's the first prayer that we learn. And we learn to say it by rote, even in Greek and in English, but in all languages. So I guess I would say to you that this prayer passes over our lips, but often never touches our hearts and minds. It doesn't really form and shape us in terms of who we are as Christians, being the Lord Jesus' disciples. So I would say, if you were to ask, what is a Christian? Certainly one of the answers that you could give is, a Christian is someone who prays the Lord's Prayer and really means it. Someone who prays this prayer, submits himself to Jesus Christ, prays as he taught us, and therefore lives as the Lord Jesus taught us. So I also need to say, because there's some confusion about this, even among Orthodox Christians, the Lord's Prayer is the prayer above all other prayers, even the Jesus Prayer. Now, I'm not minimizing the importance of the Jesus Prayer as a spiritual discipline, but it does not take the place of the Lord's Prayer. Why? Well, because the very first thing I need to say about this prayer, the Our Father, it comes directly from the mouth of the Lord himself. It is the Lord's Prayer. And as St. Cyprian of Carthage said in his commentary on the Lord's Prayer, St. Cyprian was a North African bishop. He was trained as a lawyer. He converted to Christianity. Now, he says that this to pray, the Lord Jesus has furnished us with a format for prayer. He himself has shown us what to pray for and how to pray so that we may be more readily heard as we speak to our Father in the very words that his Son has taught us. Then he asked these questions, rhetorical questions. What prayer could be more spiritual than the one given us by Christ, who also sent us the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost? What prayer to the Father could be truer than the one framed by the lips of his Son, Jesus Christ, who is, as he tells us, the truth. Now, the very first prayer rule that was ever given in the life of Christianity is talked about in an ancient document that in English is called the Didache, or the Teaching of the 12 Apostles. Most modern scholars date that document from somewhere between 90 and 150 AD. So it's been lost for centuries, and it was rediscovered in 1873 in the library of the Patriarchate of Jerusalem. It was kind of a miraculous discovery. I won't go into the details today. But in fact, the Lord's Prayer is found in that document. And it says in that document that Christians, real Christians, pray that prayer three times a day. That is the very first rule of prayer ever given in the life of our church. And in fact, the Lord's Prayer is found in virtually every service of the church. It's found in Matins or Orthros. It's found in Vespers. It's found in the marriage service. It's found every liturgy, of course. It's found in almost every service that we pray because it is the Lord's Prayer. Now, that prayer was not taught to the first people who wanted to enter the church until after they were baptized. People like, well, St. Cyprian of Carthage, St. Cyril of Jerusalem, St. Ambrose of Milan, they will even say that it is impossible for a person to pray the Lord's Prayer until they've been baptized, until they've died and risen in Christ and received the Holy Spirit. In other words, until you were baptized, and most such baptisms in those days, not all, most, were of adults, you were not even capable of saying the Lord's Prayer. You were not competent to do so. So this leads to an important point from my point of view, anyway, that you can actually pray wrongly. It is possible for us to pray in a way that is not pleasing to God. For example, we need to notice what the Lord did not say to the disciples. You know that in Luke's gospel, the disciples go to him, one of them goes to him and says, "Teach us how to pray." And the Lord Jesus responds by saying, "When you pray, say." And then he gives them the Lord's Prayer. Now, notice what Jesus didn't say. He didn't say, "Oh, it's okay, pray in your own words, say whatever you want to say. Just tell God what's on your heart. It really doesn't matter what words you use." He doesn't say that. Jesus gives us very specific words to pray to serve as a model for all prayer, especially by those who would call themselves his disciples. Now, another example in terms of praying wrongly, you all remember that we read before Great Lent, the parable of the publican and the Pharisee, the tax collector and the Pharisee. And you know the story. You know that two men go up to the temple to pray. One is a crummy, stinking, lousy, no good tax collector. And the other is a Pharisee who is professionally religious, a teacher and a keeper of the law. They go up to pray, but notice, if you can recall the parable, notice that Jesus says it's the tax collector who's standing off to the side, not even able to lift his eyes to heaven, and who's saying, "God, have mercy on me, a sinner," who goes home and writes with God, while the Pharisee, who basically says, "God, I am really wonderful. I tithe. I give 10% off the top. I fast twice a week. Thank God I'm not like everybody else, especially that tax collector that's over there." And in fact, in the original Greek, it says he was standing there and praying pros se afton. He was praying to himself. His prayer was about him. It was not about God. And so it's possible, because his prayer was pure ego, for us to pray wrongly. And so the Lord's Prayer is a model of what it means to pray rightly. Now, There are, in fact, a couple of versions of the Lord's Prayer, one in Matthew's Gospel and one in Luke, and they're a little bit different, but we're going to use, for the purpose of our conversations today, we're going to talk about Matthew's version, because that's the version that's used by all Christians. It is the one that those of us who were raised in the church originally had to learn in Greek, or maybe in Arabic, or in some other language. But it is Matthew's prayer that we learn. So, and in fact, there are many, many different saints who have made commentaries on the Lord's Prayer. And I'm going to be using some of their commentaries to discuss the meaning of the Lord's Prayer so that we can understand this, so that when we pray it, we can think about the meaning of the words that we're going to be saying and how they should affect our life. So, if you listen when you pray the Lord's Prayer, one of the things that you notice, or you should notice, is that you begin with the phrase, "Our Father." Now, that phrase, "Our Father," is unique in English in many ways. In most other languages, the first word of the Lord's Prayer is not "our," it's "Father." So in Greek, it's "pater imon." In Latin, it's "pater nostro." In Slavonic, it's "oshe nash." So in most other languages, the prayer actually begins with a cry to God as our Father. And we know that in the Aramaic that Jesus would have originally taught that prayer, that word is Abba, Abba, which is just simply a word used that connotes, has the connotations of family intimacy. As if in Greek or in English, you addressed your dad as Papa. So I want to look at those two words first, "our" and "father," and what those words are really all about. So something that's very important to say about the Lord's Prayer, especially for us living in contemporary America, is that the Lord's Prayer is definitely not a me prayer. Note that the words "I," "me," "my," and "mine" just aren't in the prayer. It's "our Father." It's not a me prayer, it's a we prayer. Not "my Father," but "our Father." Now, you have to understand that the Lord Jesus Christ himself is the only one in the Gospels who refers to God as "my Father." Notice he teaches the disciples to pray to "our Father" because the disciples themselves are part of the new community that the Lord Jesus is creating. Notice that there are 12 disciples, one for each of the 12 tribes of ancient Israel. And so the Lord Jesus is constituting a community. He's constituting, in a certain sense, a new Israel by constituting the church, by constituting us and calling us together. Now, if you look at American magazines, and I know I've mentioned this to you before, probably on numerous occasions, if you look at the history of American magazines over the last 50 or 60 years, what you see is very much a narrowing focus. So, the very first magazine I want to mention is Life Magazine. People my age remember Life Magazine. We remember it because it was all about all of life. You could find everyone and everything in Life Magazine. But then you notice, by the late 60s and early 70s, Life Magazine starts to wane. And what comes out next? It's People Magazine. It's no longer all of life, it's just people. And then, of course, a few years later, you get Us Magazine. So not all people anymore, just us, which presupposes there's a them that we don't like. And then, of course, by the time you get to the early 80s, it's just simply Self Magazine. The Lord's Prayer is against all cultural praying that prayer is, especially at this moment in our history. So even back, gosh, I'm really dating myself now. In 1979, a book came out by a psychiatrist. His name was Christopher Lash. He wrote a book called The Culture of Narcissism, writing about American culture. Baby boomers were the me generation. But in the Lord's Prayer, there's no room for that kind of narcissism. So whenever we pray the Lord's Prayer, whenever we say that word, our, we immediately acknowledge that we are intimately connected to a community of believers, the church, the household of God, the family of God, fellow citizens with the saints, St. Paul calls us, and the body of Christ, of which we are just limbs. We are connected to one another in the most intimate of ways. So even when I pray this prayer, the Our Father at home, in my room, with the door shut, before my icons, and I always say, Our Father, I realize at once that I cannot pray to God apart from the family of believers, from everybody else that's here in the church. We are bound together by the blood of Jesus, who came not to save us merely as individuals, but to create a new community, as I said a few moments ago. So when I pray the Our Father, I should always realize that I'm part of this larger family, the body of believers of every race, culture, and language, and all of the saints down through the ages. So when we speak of a personal relationship with God, yes, it is personal, it is intimate, but it is never merely private. It always involves everyone. Now, when we say in the liturgy, we dare to call you the Heavenly God Father and to say, and then we begin to say the Lord's Prayer, notice the language. Tolman epikaliste is the original Greek. We dare to call you, to invoke you. We dare to do this because when we are praying the Lord's Prayer, when we're addressing God, we have to realize who we're addressing. And I think a good way for us as modern people to understand who we're addressing is to begin to look at some of the photographs from the Hubble telescope. If you begin to look at any of those photographs, you begin to see how tiny and insignificant we are in the universe, and yet God has created us in His own image and given us infinite worth. Each one of us is worth more than every star in the universe. We are created in God's image and likeness, and that is the source of our dignity as human beings, and that can never be taken away from us, ever. So we only need to think of the immensity of the known universe, the God who created our galaxy with its 100,000 million stars, distant suns light years away, that God, but that God who also created snowflakes, whales, hummingbirds, angels, and us. That's the God that we're addressing as our Father, as our Abba, as our Papa. It's precisely that incomprehensible God we call God in the liturgy, ineffable, invisible, inconceivable, incomprehensible, forever existing yet always the same. That's the God we're addressing as Papa. Now, you have to understand that we can do this only because of Jesus Christ and only in the Holy Spirit. So there is a certain sense in which this prayer is a Trinitarian prayer. What do I mean by that? So St. Paul writes in his letter to the Galatians, you are all of you sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. As many of you as were baptized in Christ, you've all been clothed with Christ. And God sent His Son that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are His sons, He says to the Galatians, God has poured the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father, Papa. So So the gift of the Spirit is the gift of a conscience, John says in his first letter. And this word, Abba in Aramaic, as I mentioned earlier, very much a prayer that's given by the Son to address the Father. But we can only do that. Tremendous amount of just heaven. Now, when we say this prayer in Elizabethan English, many young people don't. Not in the heavens, who art in heaven. In English, it's singular. Oendis uranis in the original Greek, though, is plural. So we're praying to our Father who is in the heavens, plural. And in other words, by using not the singular, but transcendent. He transcends the no papa with such intimacy through Christ in the Holy Spirit, the creator of the universe, 100,000 million stars and 100,000 million galaxies, that God with intimacy. So already in just the first two phrases of the prayer, we have tremendous intimacy combined with a tremendous emphasis on God's incomprehensibility, how amazing and wondrous and stunning it is for us to address this God with that intimacy.